Hey everybody, Shane Presley here, Rock Paper Podcast, to tell you about my friend's music record shop. Find them at 4191A Manchester Avenue in the heart of the Grove. They've got brand new vinyl coming in every Friday. This Friday, they have records from The Replacements, Black Sabbath, Monkees, Devo, The Cars, Blue Man Group, Bad Company, Megadeth, Aerosmith, Motley Crue, and all kinds of stuff. So go down there, check it out. They've got this, or 10% off all new purchases, free beer from Four Hands Brewery, new vinyl spinning in store. If you want to find out more information, go to their Facebook, Twitter, Instagram pages, or musicrecordshop.com.
Yeah, this is Rock Paper Podcast with Shane and his guests. You will listen to what he says.
Podcast is kind of like it's like a radio show that's not on the radio, it's on the internet. Does that make sense?
Uh-huh.
Yeah, that's also like my mom. It makes it sound more confusing, doesn't it? It sounds like this.
Hey, what's up, everyone? This is Tyler from Tear Out the Heart, and you're listening to Rock Paper Podcast.
Take me back to another sunrise behind the world.
life doesn't fight fair, so why should I? Life doesn't fight fair, so why should I?
Hey everybody, Shane Presley here, Rock Paper Podcast, episode 168, coming to you from St. Louis, Missouri. I guess I should have started before, but is it pronounced Kasch?
Kasch. Yeah.
All right, so Tyler Kasch.
Tyler Kasch now.
Yeah. Of Tear Out the Heart. Welcome to the show, man.
Thanks for having me, man.
I've started a couple of them this way, and I always feel bad, like I should probably take care of it before, and then I've mispronounced people's names in the past, so I'm trying to try to avoid it at all costs.
Well, mine's new, so yeah. I can see it being tricky.
Yeah. That was when you were recently married, right? And
yep.
That's when.
Yep.
So congratulations, man.
Thank you.
Exciting stuff.
I appreciate it.
Yeah. I'm also recently married as of September 2014, so we're still, you know, fairly newlyweds.
Nice. Congratulations to you as well.
Thank you. Yeah. Yeah, it's exciting stuff. So Tyler and Tear Out the Heart have a big show coming up February 5th at the Ready Room in St. Louis, Missouri. And you got Welcome Home, the Weekend Routine, A Promise to Burn, and Make Room.
Yep.
Opening up for you. Come out to that show. Make Room, man. Those guys, just saw them the other night. I ran into you there as well. The Story of the Year, Fivefold, Hush List, Make Room show at the pageant. And Make Room, man. Those guys,
they do well.
Blew me away,
I got there too late. Yeah. I got there a little too late, but I wanted to check them out. That's huge. It's awesome for them.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. It was really a great. I mean, like for. I'm sure they had friends and family and fans in the audience, but for a lot of us, I think they were fairly unknown. There's, you know, new guys still, you know,
right.
getting going at it. And
they're a heavier band. Right?
Yeah.
And we. That's always we were direct support to Story last time they did this hometown takeover thing. And I felt like their crowd's like mixed, you know, Story of the Year crowd. Like they have the people that like have kind of followed them through their career and know that they have more aggressive music.
Yeah.
And then they have the people that have no idea that are just kind of like, oh, I've heard them on the point, you know. So if it's anything like we did have a welcome, like we did feel very welcome. But at the same time, you had like the people up in the balcony that were kind of like, you know, given the weird looks, like why is this guy yelling? What is he doing? So I can only imagine it was probably somewhat of a because they're a heavier band as well.
Yeah, they I guess like I think it's Joey is the lead singer, and he sings a lot more like clean vocals, and then there's a guitar player singer that does the screaming and stuff, but the instrumentals are pretty heavy and stuff.
Oh, so their vocalist, their front vocalist is a singer.
Right.
Okay, I did not know. See, I've known the dudes are super nice. I've seen them, met them a few times out in public, but I've never really gotten to completely dive into their band, which I'm excited to see them on the 5th.
Yeah, I think I like YouTubed a video or song and kind of got a little taste of what they're about. But I also, I really enjoy kind of going into a show and discovering new music that way too, like something completely new and, you know,
take it all in and see what they're about, and especially live, like, it just, it's hard to really judge a band until you've seen them do it live. And but I thought they were really great. And they, you know, took command of the room, for, you know, which is pretty impressive for younger guys and a sold out show at the pageant. And, right. and they got people moving and dancing, and it was really cool. So
that's awesome. That's awesome.
And then, another part that I thought was really cool was, Adam from Story jumped out there and played guitar with him on the last song.
I saw that. It's awesome. Yeah, that's super cool that, you know, he still comes out and supports, and, you know, that they're all still as close, and it all still works and makes sense.
Yeah.
Very rare in the music industry is that the case. I would think, you know, I've been in several bands, and I've been in lots of bands with lots of people, and very rarely do I feel like if someone exits a band, is it like mutual, quote unquote? They always say mutual. So it's cool to see that it actually is mutual and that they're friends and, you know, they still support each other. And what they do. That's awesome.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah. That's, and then Adam jumped back on stage. I thought that was really fun how they did that too, when Adam jumped on stage with Story, because they did like, Ryan and Phil did like the backflips, and then Ryan stepped off stage, and then Adam jumped on the stage and played his guitar and stuff, and like, I thought it was just a lot of fun. Like, it was kind of like, you know, like a tag team match or kind of thing or whatever.
Right.
Like,
yeah.
you're in. So, anyway, great show. And like I said, ran into you there and said hey, and I mean, it was one of those shows, like, especially Story, you know, and the hometown thing like that, like they've been doing. It's just fun to see who all shows. I mean, I walk into the audience and I'm like seeing all kinds of people, you know, all these.
Well, they make it an event. Yeah. You know, and that's what's awesome about St. Louis is, like, I feel like if you are a decent enough band and you are very loyal to your fan base and where you're from, and then you make your events, your show's events, you know, like, it'll be forever. You know, like, there's a reason why The Urge has been as massive of a band as they have in St. Louis, you know, like, selling out the pageant two nights in a row, you know, whatever the deal is, because people are like, oh, well, you know, they grow with the band, their fans are growing with their band, because they're not getting younger, I mean, maybe some, but, you know, for the most part, they're growing with the band, and they're like, well, this is that one time a year, you know, twice a year that I'm going to get out of the house, because I know it's worth getting out of the house for, because they're going to put on a great show, and... you know, they're going to make it an event. And I really hope that we can do that, because we try to play less. We try to, like, when we do play in St. Louis, we try to make it more of, you know, just an overall good night. And not just like, hey, buy tickets to come see my band. You know, hey, we're doing the same thing that we did last time. You know, change it up and, you know, add some different variety as far as music goes. You know, like on the 5th, we got, you know, we have pop punk bands playing. We have, like, you know, pop rock and, you know, metal and, you know, all across the board, because we don't want it to just be one type of music. We don't want people to show up, and we also don't want to oversaturate it and put a band full, you know, show full of 6 to 8 bands, you know, that all sound the same, or it's we try to limit what we do, and we try to, like, bring something new to the table each time. And I hope it, you know, becomes a trend, like, you know, has been with Story and like it has been with The Urge for you know, years and years and years. And this Story kills it, and they you know, they do a great job every single time, and especially this last time, I think they did a really good job of mixing in different songs than they normally wouldn't play, you know, and kind of branching out, because I mean, they have like 5 records now at this point, so why not, you know?
Yeah, they said a couple times there was like maybe 2 songs that they, I think, maybe, or yeah, I think it was like at least 2 that they hadn't ever played live, like that was the first time. And then they debuted a brand new song, which is unreleased, so that was
cool. It, which is awesome, because I actually know the song, because I'm on it.
Yeah.
Like, we've been recording demos in pre-production with Dan for our new record.
Yeah.
And he's a really awesome dude, good friend, and super like helpful, and he's helped us out a lot as me personally, and like for what the future is for my band. And he was like, yeah, you know, like, we're gonna record some yelling and some some gang vocals. He wanted to come over, so we came over and just, you know, did some stuff. And the song's awesome. And I really, it's cool to finally see them getting the gears rolling, because I know that they've been talking about it for a while. But, I mean, I can only imagine being a band that long and then wondering what you need to do. Because we wonder that all the time. And we're, you know, quote-unquote, younger band, you know. And you talk more than you actually do things, because you're always worried about, like, what people are going to think, you know. And even when you do the whole "we don't care what people think" kind of thing, you're still thinking about it, you know. Like, yeah. you're still going out of your way to produce something that's, like, out of the ordinary. And so it's cool that they finally did something, and it sounds really good. And it's something, you know, that I think a lot of Story of the Year fans will grasp and like.
Yeah, definitely. I mean, that it was sounded great live. I didn't catch the name of it, but yeah, it's should be cool. Hopefully, like Dan mentioned, possibly getting at least a teaser or something out soon. So,
well, they need to, hopefully they get a record out. That'd be awesome, and then take us on tour.
Now we're talking.
Yeah.
So yeah, you've become buddies with Dan. Like he's been in on your record and the video you guys recorded together too, the Coffin Eyes, right?
Yeah.
And was that the only one you did with him?
I did it last winter. I did a cover song with him as a present to my wife now. He helped, and he wrote and recorded and like majority of the music, you know, and helped me, and we just kind of got in a room and worked together. And like I said, he's just been very helpful and just very open. The dude just loves music, and I think that's obvious, like through the Fuck Off and Dies. I'm allowed to say fuck.
Yeah, right? Oh yeah.
Okay, cool. Good. You know, through the Fuck Off and Dies, it's just like, you know, it's good, serious, not serious, but it is good punk rock music, but. You can tell he does that because he loves music, and you know, he wants to try something new, and he's always open to trying something new. Like when he was recording, we're recording, like I said, these new demos with him now, to like get the wheels turning on our record, and I'll like, you know, track, and I'll go, "How does that sound?" And he'll go, I don't know, man. Like, you know, like, this is new to me. Like, you're in there growling like a damn idiot. Like, you know, like, it sounds good, but, like, I don't know, like, how to tell you to do it differently, you know? Yeah. And then, like, he's sort of, like, you know, but he was, like, interested, and he wanted to, like, you know, learn, and he wanted to get more hands-on with our music, which was awesome. And then he learned, he was like, oh, you know, like, why don't you take another drink of that beer? Or, like, you know, like, it sounds like you need to, you know, let's do... I call them cavemans, because, like, they're real low. So he'd be like, all right, let's do these cavemans. Like, he just knew the terminology, and he knew, like, how to, like, kind of produce, you know, even though, like, it's something new to him, you know. So he, like I said, he's always open and, like, down to do something creative and different with music, which is awesome.
Yeah, very cool. Where do you find out you can sing like that? Like, how does that come about?
Man, I guess just growing up, you know, like just making weird sounds. And I wanted to be a singer really bad. It started off like, well, actually, I guess I wanted to just be in a band. Yeah. And I don't know. I guess it was around the time of, like, you know, Green Day and Nirvana and Blink-182 and watching their home videos and the behind the musics and like. Listening to their records, and I just thought the whole idea of being in a band was, like, super cool. Even though I'm not very necessarily musically inclined. Like, I don't consider myself a musician. I consider myself more of a, like, an artist and an entertainer and, you know, a writer, like a lyricist. That's always been what I've done. And, but I guess I started out, and I guess the first thing I ever did in a band was play bass, and... We were trying to get this guy to sing, and he was really, really bad. But, like, I was realizing that I was trying to force him to sing, and he was, like, willing at least somewhat to try. And I was like, well, then I can do it. Like, in theory, if, you know, if he's trying and he's not a natural singer, he doesn't consider himself a natural singer, but he's not good and he's not willing to put the time in, at least I'm willing to put the time in. I'm putting the time in driving, you know, not driving to his house, riding to his house at that point, you know, on my skateboard and waking him up for band practice and, like, forcing him, which is ironic because that's still what I do today, you know, like 20, you know, or 15 years later, I'm still doing the exact same. It never stops.
Right.
But so I was like, okay, I'll sing. So then I started singing in local bands. And I think at that time, like, I discovered, like, heavy music. Like, it was kind of like the transition between bands, like I said, like Blink-182 and Green Day, and then hearing bands like Norma Jean and Deftones, and I guess even earlier, like, you know, Korn and Limp Bizkit and, you know, stuff like that.
Yeah.
You know, and then somewhere in there, you know, there was obviously Metallica and stuff. But I guess it was, like, kind of that transition phase where it went from, like, you know, the punk rock that I was into and alternative rock that I was into as a kid, and then, you know, the nu metal phase, I guess, kind of somewhere in there, and then discovering hardcore and metalcore, I guess, and post-hardcore at that time. Yeah, like I said, bands like Norma Jean and Under Oath, even early Under Oath, and we were like, okay, let's do something more like that. You know, and so we started incorporating the yelling, and I was bad. I mean, I wasn't terrible. Once again, I was willing to put the time in. And so, yeah, I did, and the band kind of did its thing. And I guess as we started getting older, we were realizing that I could carry a tune. You know, I could hit notes.
All right.
But trying to do that live with screaming was becoming a task, and we were trying, you know, to go for the gold and wanted to be taken seriously. So I was like, you know what, like, I'll step back a little bit. And I did, and I guess the first band I did that with was Tear Out the Heart, was I finally stepped back from both vocals, and still wrote, you know, all the melodies, all the lyrics, but, you know, whoever the singer was, you know, bass player, singer, guitar, you know, whatever, they did their own thing. And I guess that just kind of became the thing, and, you know, it showed that it was working, and it took off, and so, yeah, I guess the screaming thing was just, like, I got good at it. I mean, I've been doing it now for 10 years,
yeah.
You know, over 10 years, so, I mean, you do anything for 10 years, you're gonna get good at it,
yeah.
You know, like, so, it's natural for me now. People ask all the time, they're like, what do you do? Like, how did you, do you practice? Do you, like, warm up? Do you, I'm like, no, no, I mean, drink a few beers, like, you know, have a few drinks, like, yeah. You know, loosen up and do it because, yeah. Like, you know, I think a lot of it is just, like, self-confidence. Like, if you have confidence in doing something that, like, outrageous, like, and you push it hard enough, it'll sound good. Like, everyone that's a screamer, for the most part, I feel like is an entertainer. Like, they're definitely a unique character, and you got to have that kind of boost of confidence, I feel like, to get on stage and kind of bark,
sure, yeah.
And yell and scream at people, you know, yeah. And yeah, so that's what I do.
Yeah, I listened to a lot of Howard Stern's show, and I talked about it quite a bit on this show, but there was one time, so he's got Richard Christie on his staff. Do you ever listen to Stern at all?
I remember watching Stern when I was a kid, yeah, you know, like late at night and waiting for the naked chicks, but that was about it. I don't really listen to it.
Yeah, I love it. I've been, I got big on it when after high school, I started working some construction for a while, and so I was up every morning when he was on the radio, and so I started listening and got hooked, and then he went to Satellite, and I subscribed to that, and anyway, he's got a guy on the show, Richard Christie, who's a heavy metal drummer, played in like Iced Earth and some stuff. Some anyway, a couple different bands, but he really great drummer. But he's all about, you know, heavy music like that stuff too. And he introduced Howard to like I think it's K9, the band, and it's got like a actual like Pitbull lead singer or something like that. Like,
that's awesome.
I was like, I had never heard of it, but like, it was, so, but yeah, it was just funny to me that like it sounds that you mentioned barking, as you were singing
right.
To me, and it reminded me like, just cause it sounds like, it's funny how like they have a pit bull and it really doesn't sound a whole lot different than some of the, some of the stuff, like...
Well, it's super... It's crazy poetic if you can, like, yell out an emotion in a word that, like, you believe in that strongly. You know what I'm saying? Like I said, it's an outrageous thing. It's not... It's supposed to be not norm, you know? Like, that's... Metal music, in a nutshell, in general, is to be, you know, chaotic representation of emotions, you know, and be like, look at this, this is what we can do. Not kind of like, you know, like, for popularity necessarily or anything. I mean, some of it, yeah, but I think it's just, you know, people get bored with the typical turn on the radio and hear the same songs over and over and over and over again.
Sure.
And they look for that sudden jolt of just, like, energy and, like, you know what I'm saying? Because like, typically I'm not listening to a lot of metal, especially a lot of metal nowadays. Mm-hmm. But I do, and I enjoy the, like, lifestyle, and I enjoy, like, the, you know, the idea and the concept behind it, because it's you know, like I said, if it's anything but boring.
Yeah.
You know, it'll uplift you, If you're in a bad mood, it'll help get rid of the bad mood. If you're like in a good mood, it can put you in a bad mood. It'll do something, like, sure. You know, it'll do something. You know, it'll move you. Mm-hmm. And I mean, it's very primitive, you know, in some cases, and it can sometimes be pretty silly, but it undoubtedly will always be an impactful thing.
Yeah.
And it's never boring.
Sure. Well, I mean, that should be any music. If you're anything you're listening to, or you know, take time to listen to, it should be, you know, thought provoking and emotion, you know, invoke that emotion in you and stuff. I mean, you know, like going with, like, elevator music and stuff. You don't want to just sit there and listen to that because it's just kind
of. Yeah, but I mean, I do feel like a lot of people don't want to be the average consumer don't want to be thought provoked. They don't want they just want to hear something that they don't know why they like it.
Yeah.
Maybe don't even know the words. They just know the melody, and it puts them kind of in a good mood without knowing that they're in a good mood. I feel like. But, I mean, you know, that's not saying that all music's that way, but top 40 and, you know, they don't like to break out of that, you know, mold because they just want people to be smiling and not know why they're not smiling, you know. Music like metal and, like, rap, you know, it's like, even country music nowadays is, like, they're all so outrageous. Because they want to make a change. They want you to stop and look at the radio and be like, oh, what? Like, do I like what I'm listening to? And then, like, figure out, you know, later on, you're like, yeah, that was awesome. You know, instead of just, you know, like, the new Taylor Swift song or, you know, whoever. Not that I don't like Taylor Swift, nothing against that. But she doesn't make music to where you, like, you know, look down and go, oh, like...
Yeah.
She makes music to where you can go about your day and actually have a good day, like, you know, go to your 9-to-5, leave, and put on the radio and be like, oh, yeah, you know, like, it's that feel-good vibe, which is awesome, but I think, you know, metal is not about the feel-good vibe, necessarily. It's about making any sort of impact on the listener.
Mm-hmm. Well, and I think, I think for any, like, you know, typically metal, there's a lot of pain behind a lot of those lyrics, you know, and the listener can relate to a lot of the situations sometimes that are, you know, the lyrics or, you know, and things like that. They can connect to some of that stuff in there. So, I don't know. I just feel like that's probably where, you know, you develop that. I mean, it happens a lot in, I think, in any music, really, too. But I feel like metal's probably the most of it, like, where you're gonna hear this guy pouring out his heart and, you know, in these lyrics, and then you're going to say, well, you know, that means a lot to me. I can relate to that message or whatever, you know, like, I've been there and that kind of stuff.
So. It's cool to see. I think that it's coming around more now. I've talked about it before in several, like, conversations. Just, it's cool to see that, like, the vulnerability is, like, more of a thing now in, like, in metalcore again, you know, because, like, for a while it was all about, like, partying and like, you know, look what I have, look what you don't have, like, you know, fuck this, I'm gonna fuck this bitch, you know, like, it was almost like a rap mentality. It was just an outrageous kind of thing for a while, and the emotion, I think, kind of fell at the wayside, you know, and it's cool now to see, like, the post-rock and emo revival, and, you know, everything that happened once is going to come back around again. It's, mm-hmm. it's just people like reliving and they like revisiting things. And I think that the emotion is coming back into the music, which is rad. And that's awesome because that's more up my alley.
Yeah.
And like I said, that's more, I consider myself more of a lyricist. So it's cool, like, to be able to put myself out there on an emotional limb and have the support, you know, and not necessarily have the backlash of like, oh, well, we don't really want to hear about that. We just want to hear you bark. You know, we want to hear you yell. Like, it's cool to like put something behind it and then and be thinking while I'm doing it, should I do that? You know, like, should I really say that? Like, you know, but then doing it, and then when you play it for people and they're yelling it back at you, it's like, okay, that's awesome.
Yeah.
You know, that's, I was able to put myself out there, and now it's something that you can relate to, we can both relate to, and it's like a super, like, you know, like organic and empowering like feeling. And that's awesome that I think it's starting to come back around even a lot more.
Yeah. What gets you into songwriting? I mean, is that just you just had all these thoughts in your head and wanted to get it out there, or when did you discover you can write these lyrics and stuff?
I've always been a writer. I remember like my mom, like when I was a little, very little kid, she said that she used to try to give me crayons, and I would like tell her I wanted like pads of paper and pens, you know, like I would just always want to be writing stories, and like even if they didn't make any sense at the time, you know, like I was just always about writing. And you know, I look at all my old, like my old toy boxes and like all my old stuff, and like I'm writing on it, you know, like even if it's like somewhat of a couple of words that you can make out and then not really anything. I started really early, and I remember keeping journals, you know, before like social media was even like a real thing, which is like not really much of a dude thing, obviously, you know, by definition, it's more of, always been more of a female, you know, like, oh, I'm going to write in my diary, you know?
Right. Yeah. I don't know. I think that's, media and things, everybody want, they, you know, we're supposed to, by definition, like we're supposed to be, you know,
right,
kind of lock that down inside. Whoa, and forget about it. But I think that, you know, if you're able to do that, you're a lot more evolved and you're in touch with your, it doesn't, you know, there's, but, you know, by standards, like they think that we're supposed to be some macho men and stuff, but it's like, if you can write a beautiful message and, or, you know, and all this stuff, it's not, you know, I don't know, it's not less manly or anything.
Right. But, yeah. It's just, I think my friends were more like, they were more involved in, like, the now.
Yeah.
Like, not that I wasn't playing hockey, and not that I wasn't, like, I've just always been in love with nostalgia and traditions. Mm-hmm. And, like, that's just me. Like, I love, like, you know, getting together with friends and reliving the past. And it can be a healthy thing, and it can be a not so healthy thing, obviously. But that's just, you know, who I am.
Yeah.
So I always remembered being the, you know, I wanted to remember everything, and I wanted to write it all down. And, you know, so I just wrote and wrote, and then it, you know, translated into, like, you know, I like the idea of being in a band. And I was like, oh, I get to, like, you know, even when we had that other, you know, even when my very first garage band ever had any other singer, I wrote the lyrics. I remember, mm-hmm. We didn't even know what we were doing. You know, we were, like, 11, you know, 12 years old, like, being like, oh, let's be in a band, you know, and, like, recording in, like, my garage on, like, one of those Tigers Talkboy tape recorders from, from Home Alone 2.
Right.
Like, that long ago, you know, so I always just remember being the guy that was like, no, you need to do it this way. Like, I was always can be controlling, and, like, I just know what I like for my creative outlook.
Mm-hmm.
And I found, like, especially now over the years, when you're working with other people, you can't really be controlling in that spectrum. You kind of have to let them vent as well with their, you know, musical talents. And, so I guess over the years, it became like, I started playing music with Josh Spore, our guitar player, and we've been playing music together for, almost 10 years, like since 2006, 2007, somewhere around 10 years. And his thing was, he would write the music, and you know, I would give my input, but he's always written everything from our old band to the band that we're in now. Like, it's just been his job, and so he likes that kind of control on his music. And I was like, well, I like my control on the lyrics. Mm-hmm. So like, I just, when you write something and you write it down, it takes a lot for someone to be like, you can't do that.
Yeah.
You know, and I think we got to this point now where Josh doesn't tell me what I can't do with my lyrics, and I don't really tell him what he can't do with his music. Because why?
Yeah.
You obviously feel the need to do it, and, you know, that's what makes this band so great, is that we can go out there and we can do what we want to do, and we can be confident in it. And like I said earlier, you know, confidence is like a big part of being a vocalist and being in a band. Like, you don't have to be the best guitar player in the world, you don't have to be the best drummer in the world, but if you're confident and you're well rehearsed, then like you're gonna come across and you're gonna sell a good product.
Sure.
If we wanted to be told what to do, we would have went to college. You know, we would be sitting in a cubicle right now.
Yeah.
We would, you know, like making way more money but being less happy and like being told what to do. So when you're in a band, you really need to kind of like go with the flow and, you know, just like I said, but my control freakness comes in with the lyrics, and I like to like have everything make sense and wrap up and repeat and rhyme in certain spots, and
yeah,
you know, just it has to all come together in a good package. And I guess I've always been that way, so that's why I've always been down with writing.
Yeah, you were, you mentioned like a nostalgia, and I noticed you got your 64 and your Super Nintendo out here and stuff. So.
Yeah, I mean, I'm huge into video games, but for the longest time, I mean, I wasn't really into the new consoles. Like, I just didn't. I had an Xbox 360, but like, I wasn't as like intense with the gaming as I was with, like, you know, like playing Super Nintendo and playing Castlevania and, you know, Zelda and all the like original games. Like, was like big for me. So yeah, again, you know, I got Mighty Ducks right there, and got a Gremlin tattooed on my hand. Like, it's, I'm more about that, and you know, whatever.
Sure,
that's just what makes me happy, I guess.
I broke out the 64 last night. I was playing some WCW versus NWO Revenge.
Oh, Revenge,
and,
nice.
Played Blitz and some GoldenEye. So
yeah, that's awesome.
So we had a real good time.
Yeah, it sucks that, like, out of all the systems, though, the 64 doesn't translate well to HD.
You know what I'm saying?
Like, the 8-bit and the 16-bit, like, you can't go wrong. It's going to look the same way no matter what. You can blow it up massively, and it's still just going to be these little pixels.
Yeah.
But it was, like, 64 was the beginning of, like, the future of gaming.
Right.
So, like, it, sometimes you're like, man, this is, like, going back and playing GoldenEye, you're like, dude, this wasn't exactly how I remember it when I was, like, you know, a little kid playing, you know, 4-on-4. Like, you know.
Sure.
Like, that was awesome. But
yeah. Yeah, but, I remember those days, and we, that's kind of the, you know, that was the beginning, I think, of, like, the, like, LAN party and the whole Xbox Live and everything. It all started, like,
right,
with GoldenEye and the four-player screen like that. And,
right. Well, and then when we were in high school, like, starting out, like, freshmen in high school, I don't think Xbox Live was even a thing.
Yeah.
So, like, we would get together and, like, physically, like, connect our Xboxes,
right,
and, like, set up in our friend Dan's basement and, like, you know, have the TVs. And so, like, the thing of, like, oh, you're peak, like, screen looking, you know, like, screen looking was a thing.
Sure.
You know what I'm saying? Like, nowadays, like, I get on and I play Destiny on PS4 with my little brother who lives out in DeSoto, you know, like, 45 minutes, hour away. And, like, that connection is, like, It's cool and it's fun in its own way, but it's definitely not like how it used
sure.
to be, like sitting in a basement, you
yeah.
know what I'm saying? So,
yeah. You were telling me a little bit off mic there, you might be doing a little video game show kind of, or something, you're trying to do something?
Yeah, I just, like I said, I'm in love with the idea of just being creative.
Yeah.
Like, if the band has kind of got a record out and we've already done a couple of tours and I'm back home and I'm working and, like, I'll just say to Jess, I'm like, I just need to do something. You know, it's like, I feel like I'm falling victim to just, like, the normal, you know, married life now. You know, like, working and just coming home and eating and watching TV, Netflix, and going to bed. You know, like, I can't do that. So, that, like, every once in a while I feel the need to create. And the band, like, we just put out I mean, we just put out, I guess, like, what, is it like a year, like a go today, or damn close, yeah. maybe even tomorrow, yeah. or something, like Dead Everywhere came out, so it hasn't even been a year.
Yeah.
But the touring cycle was super messed up, just from, like, inner turmoil from the band, some opportunities that we had got taken, and it was just very unhealthy, and it was just awkward, so... the band has been in shambles for a long time. It's not anymore, but it was the lineup that was around for that record had been at each other's throats and just not getting along for a while. So we came home after our last tour, which was like last April, something like that, last spring, and no one wanted to do anything. Like, it was like trying to, like, just no one. Even I would say even myself was just kind of like discouraged at working with the people
yeah.
that were in the band. We didn't talk. We didn't do anything. So we were like, we played our last show. We did that, like, not our last show, but, like, you know, at that time for a while, we didn't realize it was going to be our last show for a minute. And we came home and I was like, well, I need to do something creative. What do I want to do? What do I want to do? And, you know, I'd already done the cover, which was kind of like a side project thing, but I was like, I don't really feel motivated to, like, to be in another band. I always liked the idea of it, like, talking to my friends and my buddies, being like, oh, we should start a hardcore band, or we should start a pop punk band. Mm-hmm. But I wanted to be creative, you know, in any other way. So my buddy Steve, who used to live here, he used to be in a band called Rushmore Academy back in the day, and then he was in a band called, then they went on to be Option Control for a minute. I don't know if you're familiar, but... He moved out to California a couple years back, and he's a good friend of mine. He hates a lot of the same stuff and as me, and he loves a lot of the same stuff, and we always get into these conversations when we're drunk, and we get in these real in-depth conversations where, like, most of the time we agree, but when we don't, it's, like, super, I think, entertaining, yeah. like, or we thought it was, you know? We were like, okay, well, we don't agree on this, and that's really messed up because we should, and we would just get into it. And so we came up with a concept. We're like, okay, well, let's get together. Let's have these same conversations. We'll talk about these topics. We started writing down things that, like, we were, like, wanted to talk about. And we're going to get together, and we're gonna have some beverages and discuss these topics and see where it goes. And we, like, when we did it, we got together a couple of times. One time out in L.A. and one time here. And... hopefully we can launch it, you know, but at the time it was cool to, like, kind of edit it and be creative, like, you know, like, and edit the movies and edit the sound and, you know, and even the process of, like, writing and recording the show was, like, it was a cool creative outlook for a minute. And then I guess, like, it's very tedious to edit film. Yeah. And so that's kind of got, and then the band needed to come back together, and we needed to do more band things, so it kind of got put on the back burner,
sure.
and now we're just concentrating on, you know, writing the next record and rebuilding and rebranding the yeah. band.
Well, hopefully it comes out, but I totally get that, though, man. That's a lot of why I do with doing this show is that, you know, I had my day job and stuff, and I just was looking for some creative outlet of sorts. I wrote for a while. I wrote, like, a local music blog, doing some album review kind of things, and kind of got burned out writing, and I decided to start talking. And I even when I wrote, like, I always wanted to let the music speak for itself kind of thing, you know. It's more or less just the suggestions, like, of my music, you know, that I liked, and I was like, you know, here, give this band a listen and stuff. And I would try to put different tracks on there for people to check out. And so that's kind of what I'm trying to do with the show too, is, like, more or less the audio version, and try to have put the songs on throughout the show. Or
podcasts are awesome
too. Yeah, man,
I love it. Like, I listen to podcasts more than I listened. Like, when you told me, I went and subscribed right away, because
yeah.
You know, I listen to that way more than I listen to music in my car.
I think it's really the wave of the future. Real, I mean, it's not that it's new, but it's been at it for a while, podcasting as a form. And if for me, it took a long time to get on board, because, like, I just, you know, I'd see it on iTunes or whatever and hear people talking about it, but I never really had any nowhere to start kind of thing.
Right.
Met a local comic, or not, sorry, not a local comic, but met a comic at the Funny Bone, Jay Larson, and he's like, hey, check out my podcast. So I started listening. That was the Crab Feast. Crab Feast led me to About Last Night, another one. So I like listening to the comedian ones just because I enjoy comedy and I enjoy their stories that they're telling. And I also like Nerdist podcast and stuff. But I listened to a lot of these and I kind of got hooked and I was like, man, they always sound like they're having a great time. And so my buddy Chris threw it out there one day about wanting anybody want to start a podcast. And I was like, all right, yeah, you know, I got these friends in music. We can start talking about music. And he's like, cool. So that's how it all started for me. But what podcast do you find yourself listening to a lot?
I guess what sucked me in first was Kevin Smith, because like I'm a big Kevin Smith fan. Like growing up, like for a minute there, I was really into the idea of being a filmmaker, because I remembered hearing about how he dropped out of film school and took his tuition basically, like.
Yeah,
and went and made Clerks,
right?
And you know, took out a bunch of loans, and I just remember at the time, like, you know, that I could connect to that, like that just sounded like something I would do. Like, you know, when I was 17 years old, I went out and bought a van and a trailer, and we went out on Warped Tour when I was, you know, 17 years old, like immediately, like, you know, with no like cushion, no label backing, no money, nothing, like just traveling, driving 10 hours a day, you know, like, you know, and it, to me, that I just love that rush, you know. And it sounded, he said, you know, he's like, I just decided I'm going to go for it. I'm going to do it. And it worked. It works, an awesome movie. No, not really. I mean, the idea of it's great, you know, and it's a good movie and I'll put it in, I pay attention for like 50% of it, you know, but the fact that he did it is, I think, what people like fell in love with. They're like, okay, well, if he can do it, I can do it. And I learned that he had a podcast, and you know, I heard in the van on tour, the guys would listen to conspiracy theory podcasts. You know, like what's that? Coast to Coast? Is that one? I think it's. I think it's something along those lines, but I've never been. That's not up my alley. But I remember hearing them being so. The people on the podcast being very crazy passionate about these conspiracy theories, and any person that's passionate about anything, you got my attention. Yeah. You know, so I was like, okay, cool, Kevin Smith has one. I've heard what a podcast is from the van. I'm gonna listen to Kevin Smith. Went through his Fat Man on Batman thing all the way through, and yeah, and then just started researching. You know, I listened to that, and there's a couple of PlayStation podcasts that I listen to.
Sure.
That, and I'm not completely pumped on them, you know, like the PlayStation podcast or the gaming. I don't feel like there's one that's a definitive one, which is another reason why we kind of like decided to try to do our own, because it was something that I was really in love with. The singer of Silverstein recently started one, like a couple months back, called Lead Singer Syndrome, where he interviews like each week is like a different lead singer, and that's pretty cool too.
Yeah.
So I'm all over the place. Like I'd rather listen to the podcast than like recycle the same music.
Sure.
You know, while I'm driving around.
Yeah, I mean, I'm just a fan of conversation. I enjoy you know, hearing different takes on things. And And that was for this show, and I think what's offered some of the success that this show has gotten was just that there's nobody doing a St. Louis music podcast, so like it helped having a, you know, being a kind of a one of kind instead of falling in where there's already movie ones, gaming
right.
ones, and things.
No, yeah, it's awesome too, because I feel like St. Louis has a lot of. I feel like St. Louis has a lot of really good ideas and a lot of talent in it. But I feel like St. Louis is kind of like me. Like, they're very much based on nostalgia, like, and being set in your ways. Like, you like to go to the same bar.
Sure.
You like to eat the same kind of pizza. You know, you like to go to the same shows. Like, which is awesome. Like I said, that is almost me to the T. Yeah. You know what I'm saying? But it's cool to see, you know, it's awesome. Every once in a while, someone's like, yeah, I'm going to step out. I'm going to do something different. And it's cool that, like, when you asked me to do the podcast, I was like, dude, that's awesome. I've never gotten... we've done all these video blogs on YouTube, all these YouTube channels on tour, and I've done radio, or, you know, interviews with, you know, the Revolver and Alternative Press, like, over the phone and stuff like that, which is awesome.
Yeah.
But it's really cool to be able to, like, be like, oh, I can listen to this on the podcast app on my phone.
So it's your first one, then?
Yeah, it's my first official podcast, yeah.
Man.
I'm pumped.
Yeah, very cool. Yeah, I mean, you know, if you do like all that nostalgia stuff, I've had a lot of the guys, five-sixths of the band from The Urge.
Cool.
So those guys are on here. Guys from El Monstero. So anyway, just a lot of my favorites from around town. Like, you know, there's some of the guys have been at it for a while, and then there's the guys that I was their very first interview. So it's pretty cool to, you know, have that range, you know. So,
absolutely.
But anyway, I put out online yesterday, people submit some questions for you. So if you don't mind answering questions from the fans.
I saw some I had some shithead friends on
that's usually where it goes. Either if I have a lot of comics on here too, and they you know, they got all their smart ass comic friends that answer, you know, throw a bunch of stuff on.
Right, I can imagine comedians like little bit even more intense.
But no, I think there's some pretty good ones on here. Here we go. Patrick asks, who is the greatest Batman of all time?
Yeah, Patrick is the gentleman who shot Patrick Lawrence, correct? Yeah. He's the gentleman who shot our Coffin Eyes video.
Oh, okay.
Gentleman, I use that loosely.
Yeah. He also fivefold videos.
He's a good dude, and he's very, very creative.
Yeah.
Him and I disagree a lot on movies, and he also doesn't like a lot of movies. But my thing is I love Batman. It's one of my favorite franchises by far. I got the Batman PS4. The Arkham series is like the only series that I've bought when it came out and beat. Like, I have to beat each game, you know. Mm-hmm. But he always makes fun of me because I believe I have a very unpopular opinion on who the best Batman is, and that's because I go with George Clooney.
Yeah.
Okay. I think George Clooney was the potentially the best Batman, definitely the best most believable Bruce Wayne, but he was just in one of the worst movies.
Yeah.
And so I don't feel like he got a fair trial for what he did. And George Clooney's even said that he's embarrassed that he even did it and all this other stuff in interviews. But I didn't think it was that bad. And growing up, I think I was like, at that point, Batman and Robin, I think is, what, like 99, maybe? Yeah, like real late 90s. So like, I was like, that was when I was really getting, you know, I was at the prime of understanding what I was watching. So Batman and Robin will always have a special place in my heart because, you know, the Batman the Ride happened, Mr. Freeze happened at Six Flags. You know, like, all the toys that were coming out. Like, it just... That, for the, you know... Once again, the nostalgia factor will always be a good play. Also, very unpopular opinion, I'm not the biggest Tim Burton fan.
Yeah.
So, he does have some good things. I don't believe Batman and Batman Returns are some of them. Like, it does not hold up to what I remember when I was a little kid.
Yeah.
You know, going back on it now, I can't really watch them. And because of Tim Burton, you know, so many people will say Michael Keaton is the best Batman. For me, acting Batman is 75% Bruce Wayne and 25% a guy in a mask that says a couple of lines, right? So, like, did he do good as Batman? Yeah, like, his voice didn't offend me. Like, yeah, like, I mean, some of the scenes were cool with him as Batman. That's fine. But that's 1/4, as far as I'm concerned, of what the character of Batman is. And as a billionaire playboy, I just didn't buy Michael Keaton.
Yeah.
You know, I love Michael Keaton, you know, Multiplicity and Beetlejuice and what, Mr. Mom?
Multiplicity is so funny.
It's awesome. He's hilarious and he's really funny.
Yeah.
But I just don't buy him as like a serious billionaire playboy.
Sure.
So he'll say that. So for me, it's George Clooney or Christian Bale that offend me either, because he's more of a believable Bruce Wayne. Yeah, his voice is kind of, you know, people have a problem with that, but that didn't bother me. But But you know what? Honestly, out of all of them too, like I have high hopes and good expectations for Ben Affleck.
Yeah, I'm interested to see how that goes. I agree with that. Like, I think if I'm sure if like Clooney was in Dark Knight or something, you know, a better film, it probably would have been a much better fit. But yeah, that, you know, just it wasn't.
It was campy and kind of, which is cool, but like I think he had an unfair movie. So, but he's the dude's a stud. Like, you know, he's always been like, I'm not getting married. You know, like I'm with all these chicks. You know, like he's been very like public about, you know what I'm saying, like just being like having open relationships and like and spending money in obscene ways and just being rich and just being awesome, and like that's kind of what. You know, even though Bruce Wayne does, like, you know, have certain love interests, that's supposed to be the overall conception of Bruce Wayne. So, and Ben Affleck's kind of the same way. He's just a cocky, good-looking, older, now, like, you know, rich guy. So I could see him doing a good job as Bruce Wayne. So Michael Keaton, though I love him, and he's great in Beetlejuice and all that, I just didn't believe him so much as Bruce Wayne. So, and Val Kilmer was the worst.
By
far the worst. So... But the best I'm gonna have to go with George Clooney until I see Batman v Superman. Then I'll reevaluate.
Addison asked, "Does Tear Out the Heart plan on touring again soon?"
Yes, a good reason why we made all the changes that we did, which I guess I can be kind of vocal with it now. We've been very quiet, but there's going to be an article soon through Alternative Press that's gonna open up a lot of the questions that people have been asking. But we lost a bass player and a guitar player, and we, for a lot of reasons, creative reasons, personal reasons, just reasons, it just did not work. And they never wanted to tour, and I don't care what they say. I'm gonna keep my mouth shut about a lot of things. You know, I'll keep a lot of the fights behind closed doors. I will keep a lot of it quiet for the most part, or at least plan to. But they didn't want to tour, and they did not like touring, and they complained a lot. And every time we got a tour opportunity, it was just never good enough.
Yeah,
and it just never worked. So, you know, more power to them wanting to be here, or, you know, wanting to be at home. Like touring is extremely hard, and you're broke, you're away from home, you're away from your friends and your family, you're eating McDonald's every day, you know, like, you're sleeping in a van that's either too cold or too hot. Like, I mean, it is hard. You have to love music, and you have to love your music, and you have to love the product that you are pushing. And, you know, I do, and I love touring, and I love all the hard parts, and I love all the great parts. I love meeting all the fans, and I love traveling to different cities, and I love playing in different venues, and I love trying different food from different places, and seeing, you know, as much of the world as I can. And if I can, you know, push my music while doing it, that's awesome. So yeah, absolutely. We plan on touring a lot more than we ever have. It's going to take a slow process of getting it started. You know, the first show with the new guys is just now happening in February. You know, we have a record to record, but I can promise that once the record is done and we're on that touring cycle for the record, that we will be touring a lot more than we have in the previous, because the people that we are making sure that have replaced them and the band the way it is now, we're making sure that that is a priority of theirs as well as ours.
Very cool, man. What is his greatest fear? Your greatest fear? Press from Bobby.
Okay, see, I didn't, I saw that too, and I didn't know exactly what it was until my wife Jess was like, you know what he's talking about, right? And, I hate untangling cables.
Yeah.
So it's not my fear, okay, as much as it's a personal hell, okay? I'd be untangling cables. Well, you know, you're familiar with Willem Dafoe?
Yeah, oh yeah.
Creepy looking dude.
Yeah.
Okay. Like, having his way with me and whispering in my ear that he'll stop as soon as I untangle all the cables.
Yeah.
But I just can't untangle the cables. So I think that's I think that's what Bobby was saying. I have pinpointed my personal hell to that being that situation. Have you ever seen that movie? What is it? Devil or like Lucifer or something, and it's got Willem Dafoe in it.
No.
And it shows him like, it's like, it's a movie like where he's The opening scene is just like him and his wife, and they're like they're doing it, and it's really awkward. And then their kid like walks off their balcony. So like that's it's like a messed up horror movie.
Yeah,
he's just really creepy in it. So yeah. Willem Dafoe would definitely be there. He's one of and me untangling cables. that would be the situation.
Yeah.
Thanks, Bobby.
Yeah, thanks, Bobby. James asked, what is his dream venue to play?
I guess this could be in a few different questions. My all-time favorite venue, I think, to play would probably be Chain Reaction in Anaheim, which we have played. And every time we play, it's awesome.
Yeah.
A dream venue, now, if we're talking about, like, just pure size and idea of it, like Scott Trey would be awesome because yeah. like you, or Madison Square Garden or something, because you're just like, you know, that's outrageous to think yeah. that you would play there. Now I would say an obtainable venue that would be really awesome would just be like man, maybe the Glass House in Pomona, or like maybe like a House of Blues, like a House of Blues Chicago. Like just because like Chicago's like close enough to where if we were playing like House of Blues in Chicago, like people would sure. like be like, oh, we're going to come up from St. Louis to see this. This is definitely. Massive. But yeah, being, or Vegas, like House of Blues Vegas would be cool. House of Blues venues just in general are awesome. They're very yeah. prestigious, and I think they run their venues like very comfortably and very awesome. And even though it's a big ordeal, it's also, you know, a reasonable capacity, and it seems like it's ran very well. So yeah. any House of Blues would be cool.
Me and my buddy Dustin ran up to House of Blues Chicago a couple of years ago now. We went to see Alice in Chains and
nice.
There, and it was around when like Black Gives Way to Blue came out and stuff. That was they were touring for that album, and man, it was just awesome. Like so cool. Like especially seeing Alice in Chains in a small venue like that, and right. like compared to you know the amphitheater and stuff, and.
Well, that kind of music's like way bigger in St. Louis, I feel like. St. Louis is like going back to that nostalgia yeah. factory, and that's like 90s rock
yeah.
and alternative. Like, that is like the bread and butter for 105.7 The Point, which oh, yeah. is like arguably the biggest station in St. Louis. Mm-hmm. So, like, when they come here, Alice in Chains can sell out, you know, an amphitheater. You yeah. know, they can, you know, headline Point Fest. They can do something like that. Not that they're not already big everywhere else, but yeah, I mean, like, House of Blues would be an awesome sure. experience, you know, oh, more, yeah. little, bigger but more intimate, you know.
I have, a bucket list kind of thing to go to Red Rock someday, so that's where I, as a dream venue as a fan, I want to see a show from at Red Rocks.
Is that in Denver?
Yeah.
Yeah, I've never been to Red Rocks, but my first band played The Gorge, which is in Seattle, Washington, which is where Warped Tour was for several years, and that place is insane.
Yeah.
It's this. I imagine it's very much the same. It's out in the middle of nowhere. It's like literally all you're surrounded by just rock formations, sure. like you know, and like you're in a gorge. You know what I'm saying? And like so, like you sit up, and like the stage, all the stages are down here, and it's just land. You know, mm-hmm. you can just see land and clouds everywhere. It's awesome.
Yeah, I mean, from everything I've seen from pictures and stuff at Red Rocks, it's. It just looks, you know, absolutely beautiful. Just all natural, sort of amphitheater. You know, all rock and kind of chiseled out. Like I said, the band down at the bottom and everybody's kind of up.
Right.
But yeah, I don't know. One of these days, I got my cousins just moved over to Denver area, so now at least I'll have a couch to crash on when I pick a show to
right.
go to Red Rocks now.
I guess it would be kind of cool to say you played Wembley too, right? I mean, I mean, not just in U.S. It'd be awesome to sure. play any room over, you know, overseas. It's one thing we haven't done yet, and that's on my band bucket list is to go to Europe and Japan and be able to play shows.
Yeah, that'd be killer, man. Kyle said, "Ask you about burritos."
Well, we were. This is all stuff that's happened recently on Facebook. Yeah. It's so funny. We were talking about what justifies being a burrito. And I feel like, I mean, I told him anything that's wrapped up. Like, anything that you can, like, roll up is a burrito, right?
Yeah,
I mean, sure. I can see that. So I think that's what he was getting at.
Yeah?
Yeah.
Yeah, I think...
I mean, you can take a slice of pizza and roll it up, and I think it's considered sure. a burrito.
Yeah, pizza burrito. Yeah. Genius.
Someone needs to sell that.
Yeah, that'd be perfect for those Pizza Hut Taco Bell combos. Right. You know?
Yeah, absolutely. Get on it.
Yeah. CJ asked, would you chug mayonnaise for $1 million?
No, I just don't think it'd be possible. I'm not. Mayonnaise is one of the nastiest things ever. So yeah. I would try anything for. I'm gonna you can go on record and say I would try anything for $1 million. Pretty much.
Yeah.
I would try it. But I don't think I could succeed on that.
Yeah,
it's gonna be a little too gross.
Sure.
Plus, how do you chug mayonnaise? Really, I mean that's more of a spooning.
Yeah,
kind of
you
thing.
Definitely. Like,
you can't really drink it.
Right. Kyle said, ask you about Selena Gomez.
Oh, yeah. Kyle and Bobby are, oh, man. I bet you, if they had any idea, you're really going to ask these. Selena Gomez is,
nothing's off limits.
I got no comment on that. All right. That's a no, because, like, she's just not, I've exercised before that I don't find her as attractive as other people do.
Okay.
You know what I'm saying?
Sure.
I don't know. Like, I don't know. I guess I'm more of a. I think Katy Perry is more. I'm more of a Katy Perry guy. I guess personally.
Yeah, you know, she's
a
good looking woman. Aaron asked, did he keep his flat iron after he cut his hair?
yeah, I think I gave it to Jess. I gave it to Jess because I broke hers. So yeah, but I haven't straightened my hair in a long time. Like probably like. I don't even know. Like,
yeah.
I feel like at least 5 or 6 years at least. So it might be somewhere.
Right.
I'm sure Jess has it.
and this one was interesting to me. But Josh asked, how does the canned ravioli from a church food bank in Wisconsin taste?
Wow. Yeah, I saw that too, which is awesome. Because, like, I don't... Josh plays in bands... as well. I can't...
He's been on the show.
Has he?
Brotherly and the Leather Jackets.
Brotherly, yeah, that's what he does now. And he was... It was a Palace he was in before. It was a band called Palace.
Yeah.
I've known Josh for a long time. He's a really, really good friend of mine. I still consider him a really, really good friend. We don't talk as often as we used to, but he was definitely around a lot when me and Josh were kind of starting... to tour more and kind of like progressive musicians, because he used to play in a band called Nine Life Fire. They used to play all the time with our old band Novella, and we were kind of like brother bands. Every time we would play a show, we both played.
Mm-hmm.
Well, he crashed on my couch for like forever, just being himself, you know. We made a trip one time up to Wisconsin to see some friends of ours play a show. And we didn't have any money, and like there was no money, like barely gas money, and we just kind of went up on a whim. And the church, the show was in a church, and I guess they were doing some sort of like food bank thing,
yeah.
Right? And I guess I think he went to, like, take some or something, as bad as that sounds. Like, he was like, I gotta eat. He went to, like, go take some, but the lady was, I believe, was just like, you know, if you need this,
sure,
absolutely, like, have some of this. So that's what we ate for dinner that night.
Yeah.
He came back and he had some ravioli. Either that or he just swiped it and told me that he said this. I don't know. But he you know, he delivered the food on the plate. So
yeah.
we got to eat before we came home from Wisconsin.
Was it Chef Boyardee or just...
I don't remember.
Yeah.
I don't remember. I was probably too drunk to even know what I was eating in the first place.
I mean, that's, you know, that's the best way to...
I think it was one of those big cans, which
yeah.
I don't think I've seen. I don't know if they still do. It was like family size, like if I remember correctly.
Yeah. I think like at Walmart, I can recall like there was like an aisle, at least in mine, but there's like an aisle where they have like all these like giant portion of the things, like a huge thing of pickles and a huge thing
right,
of ketchup.
Like the Sam's Club kind
yeah.
of thing.
Yeah, and there was like I'm pretty sure on that aisle there's like a giant can of Chef Boyardee.
That's the first. That is the only time I've ever seen it. So I mean, but I'm sure it exists. But
yeah.
that was the first time, first and only time I've ever seen it.
All right, man. Well, I guess we'll look to close this thing out. Again, February 5th at the Ready Room. You can see Tear Out the Heart, Welcome Home, The Weekend Routine, A Promise to Burn, and Make Room. And I thought this was cool. You're doing $30 VIP packages. Are those still available?
Yeah, we tried it one time. Like, we didn't want to be the band that, like, I'll never, like, charge anybody to be like, oh, come get an autograph, you know, or something along those lines. So we never offered. We usually don't offer it. We're like, hey, just come to the show. We're going to be hanging out anyways. And we did it one time, and it went really well because people asked for it. And then we just didn't do it again and again. And then people were asking for it again this time because we haven't played a show in St. Louis since April, or I think last April, when we played with Devil Wears Prada. It's been a year. It's been exactly a year since we played Ready Room for our CD release for the show, for the record. And we didn't offer them then. We didn't offer the VIP packages then. And this time, we're like, okay, well, people are asking, so why not? So we were like, okay, we'll get a bunch of pizza. Like, at least we'll make it somewhat, like, we don't want to feel like we're taking advantage of anybody or trying to act cool, you know, or anything. So we're like, okay, we'll get a bunch of pizza. We'll print off some limited posters and, you know, we'll, and these people will get the chance to meet the dudes, the new guys mm-hmm. first, you know, because we're not, we didn't, like, you know, outside of this podcast and whenever that article goes live, you know, we haven't talked about the departing of the members really or anything along those lines. So, those people will get the chance to, like, meet these guys, know that they're the real deal, you know. Maybe we'll even sound check with a new song so they can hear it, you know, and, you know, and then have some pizza and some beers and just kick it and wait for the doors to open. So, we're still offering that. It's 30. That's limited. So I wouldn't see those being around for too much longer. Yeah. So if somebody is into that idea, I'd pick them up now.
Yeah, get on them now. I think that's cool. A couple of bands I follow a lot, they've done things like that. And it's just, as a fan, it's a cool experience to kind of get the little, you know, VIP treatment. The, like I said, the poster, having a limited run, and, like, laminate,
and stuff. And all, like, that stuff is way more cool, and it's way more hands-on than, like, just waiting in a line and charging people to buy your autograph, because that's just... I'll never be that person, and, you know, I would hope the band would never be that kind of band, so... And it was cool last time. You know, we didn't do the pizza or anything, but we did, like, the sound check and I think we did, like, a shirt or something, and it went over really well. So I think it'll be fun again this time.
What pizza are you gonna get?
I don't know. I guess it depends on how many people get it, right? Yeah. It would be nice to do St. Louis, right? Like, do a St. Louis style. But if we're limited to it with how many people, we might have to go more like, you know, I don't know, Papa John's. No hot and readies. We won't go hot and ready. We won't go that cheap on people, but. Hey, even though there's nothing wrong with the hot and ready's.
Hot and ready's a pretty quality pizza for $5. It's not bad.
Yeah, true. Have you had the $5 pizza from 7-Eleven yet, though?
No, I haven't done the 7-Eleven.
That is what's up.
I like Casey's gas station pizza. That's some pretty good stuff.
It is, but we don't have any. Yeah. We don't have any. We're, like, near St. Louis. Yeah, you know
I drove over to Muskuta, Illinois to record with Odom one time. And there's a Casey's, like, right outside of where we met at Gary's house, and Casey's, like, right outside his house, and I was like, oh, man, you know, like, you don't see Casey's around too much, and so I was like, man, I could really go for some pizza, that would be awesome, but it was closed by the time we got out of there, and so I was kind of bummed, but... So I've been thinking about it for since...
7-Eleven's got a great $5 pizza, like, for real, like, because it's been on tour everywhere, like, up... It just recently came to St. Louis, the, like, 7-Eleven kitchen.
Yeah, trying to keep up with the QTs, huh?
Yeah, exactly. So, which they can't hear. Which is funny, because everywhere else, like, 7-Eleven is way more common. Yeah. Or, like, you know, other gas stations, like, you know, are everywhere. Quick Trip's not really everywhere, but it's more...
Right, it's more regional.
Midwest. Yeah. And, But the pizza from there is awesome. But yeah, we'll probably get something. We'll get something good.
Yeah,
decent.
I don't know if you were Emo's guy or.
I am. I actually work for Emo's. I deliver for Emo's when we're home from tour. When, okay. Like, I deliver for Emo's, It's awesome. But as far as St. Louis style pizza, I think Alicia's is my favorite.
Yeah.
Like, also an unpopular opinion. But I like Emo's too. Like, they're both, like, I eat Emo. I eat sure. Emo's probably, like, you know, 3 times a week at least. So, yeah. Like, I obviously I love Emo's. But, just, like, when I'm sitting here and I don't want to go anywhere, I'll order Alicia's.
Yeah. I don't know if I ever had Alicia's. I try it. It's like another goal of mine in life is to try all pizza, like just to,
right,
just so I can find the greatest pizza.
Well, yeah, I would say my favorite my favorite St. Louis style is Alicia's, which is like it's the same thin as like Emo's, but it's like way more toppings, like way more cheese and stuff. Because like Emo's is like thin and crispy,
yeah.
So it's all kind of like, you know, this is like way more cheese, way more everything.
Yeah.
And then my favorite thick crust pizza in the area is definitely Happy Joe's,
okay.
Which is tied to, which is like I said, I live in Afton, yeah. And I love Afton, Webster Groves. Like I've been going to Happy Joe's Pizza like for my birthday every year since I've been, you know, since I could remember. Like it's, you know what I'm saying? Like I'm sure. Way into the like finding the places that are tight and going there all the time and nostalgia and
yeah.
So I'm Alicia's and Happy Joe's.
Well, I've never tried Happy Joe's either, so got two more to add to my list, so definitely I'll return with my review for
the next one. Let me know how it is.
But yeah, thanks, Tyler. Thanks so much for hanging out today, man. Really appreciate this. It's been a lot of fun kind of getting to know you a little better and stuff. We've kind of been running around the same scene for a while and known who you were, just never really got a chance to get to hang. And
yeah, anytime, man. Cool. I loved it, so absolutely, I appreciate it.
I can throw on some tunes. You got any personal favorites you want me to, you think I should play, or
I don't know. What have you been listening to lately?
I like Feel Real a lot. I thought that was that one.
On that record, yeah, I would go for that.
Yeah.
It's good. Or you know what? If you're gonna play a song, play The Rejected. That's my favorite song on that record. So
well, I can do two. I can do one open and one close in the show kind of stuff, but. Yeah, and that Feel Real is that's a great video too.
Cool, thank you. Yeah, that was one of the most fun. Like we shot, I know we're wrapping up, so I'll make it real quick. We shot three videos at the same time. One of them never saw the light of day, just because the members leaving and it never wound up getting released at a proper time. We shot Feel Real and I've Got Secrets at the same time, and we put a lot of more of the budget in Feel Real. You know, we had the fire and the explosives. It was awesome. Yeah. And, you know, the guy that came out and worked on the fire did, like, fire for, like, the first Transformers movie.
Okay.
And he did, like, work on, like, Planes, Trains, and Automobiles. And he did the snow in that movie. And, like, all kinds of, like, you know, practical effects. And we did it, like, out in like a rock quarry up in Wisconsin, so we were like out in the middle of nowhere, so it was pretty cool to like
nice,
and we got to blow up a van, which was awesome, you know, so
for sure
it turned out cool.
Yeah, man. Yeah, great video. So go on, you can find all the videos on the Tear Out the Heart YouTube.
Vivo. Yeah, on Tear Out the Heart Vivo, or you can just go to tearouttheheart.com.
Yeah.
Like, Victory's really good about like linking all of our media on that website.
Okay.
So
you
can go on there.
Yeah, so and you can find the Facebook, Twitter,
yeah,
links, all that on there.
Yep, tearouttheheart.com.
Cool, man. Well, thanks again, and I'll see you February 5th, man.
Awesome, man. Appreciate it. Stop!
Rock Paper Podcast, y'all.